are three people. Let's see, what should we say to each other? We could say how good everybody looks, and that would be true. Why don't you just say, I know you came expecting. Hallelujah. Or just say something edifying. Together and clap for a little bit. just put up our hands and worship Jesus here for a second? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I sing praises to your name.
Oh, Lord, praises to your name.
Sing it out, church.
Oh, Lord.
For your name is great.
For your name is great.
And greatly to be
great. And greatly to be great. I sing praises to your name. Great and greatly to be.
is great.
For your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Can I get you to just lift up your voice and worship and magnify? Come on, lift up praise in here right now. Lift up your praise to Him.
For your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Sing that out for me. For your name is great.
For your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Lift it up, church.
For your name.
Before Pastor comes, can I just admonish you in this? You know, when I first kind of switched over from just a Pentecostal setting to maybe, if you want to call it, Word of Faith, charismatic, Greg, one of the first things that hit me was when everybody just started singing in the Holy Ghost. I literally thought that you had to wait for some like lightning bolt to hit you, or at least some really good goosebump, or some really special song before you like lifted up your voice. Can anybody relate to that at all? Like the organ had to be just right, and the song had to be just right, and everything had to be just right. But then I found these, I thought they were the weirdest people I ever met in my life. But they were also the most healed, prosperous people that I ever saw in my life. Now, this doesn't sound like much to y'all, because you do it all the time. But it was stunning, staggering to me that, you mean you could sing in the Holy Ghost just when you want to? And you can pray in tongues when you choose to? You don't have to wait for Sunday night for the extra special songs and the extra good goosebumps and all that. May not sound like much. And at first I thought it was the weirdest thing I ever heard in my life. And I thought it was very uninteresting musically, because everybody sang, you know, just, they just picked a note and they sang. But I could not deny when they switched from maybe something known, and they just lifted up their voice and they started singing, just singing in the Holy Ghost. And it was so simple, but it was so pure. And it was like God just kissed the room when they did that. I thought, well, I don't completely understand that, but I know His presence just filled the room when they did that. Before Pastor comes, can we just so simply just go, oh, Ramayaradea, so we magnify, so we glorify. You just lift it up. And singers, sing in your microphones. And don't hold anything back. Sing out. I'm not singing by myself. Lord, we praise you.
Lord.
we pray.
Lord, we praise you.
Lord, we praise.
Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you.
Let's just sing hallelujah in parts if you want.
Father, we bless you in this place. We're so grateful for your presence. So thankful for your presence. So changed in your presence. So changed by your presence. So grateful, Lord. We love you and we bless you. We honor you in this place. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence. We know in your presence is where we're changed. And we're so grateful for your presence in this place tonight. And all that you're going to say and do, we just honor you, Father. And we're truly so grateful. And we thank you, Lord. And everybody said, amen. Well, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? God is so good. And I want to encourage you that if you weren't here, I was thinking if you haven't been here for the last few days, today's only Monday, but if you weren't here yesterday and you missed those sessions, you really need to go to the podcast or the website and download those messages, because there's so many answers in those teachings that I know will help you and feed you and help you to develop in your faith. Amen. And we have just been so blessed, so richly taught, and I'm grateful. How about you? Amen. Well, we're going to receive an offering for Pastor Nancy tonight, and I just have a few scriptures I want to read in Luke chapter 8 specifically. Luke chapter 8 is really, to me, some just powerful scriptures about being appreciative of those who minister in your life ongoingly. And and this is talking about Jesus. And in his ministry. And I want you to see this in Luke chapter 8, verse 1. And it says, "And it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with him. And certain women which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went seven devils. How many of y'all know she was thankful that day? And Joanna and the wife of Chuza. Chuza was just a Roman officer. Herod, Stuart, and Susanna, and many others. Look at this, which ministered. No, it just wasn't just giving. Ministered. There was something behind this offering. They were ministering unto him of their substance. And I want to read this in a different translation that I think just really brings out some things that I want to say real quick. It says, soon after this incident, Jesus preached from city to city, village to village, carrying the good news of the kingdom of God. He was accompanied by a group called the 12, and also by a larger group, including some women who had been rescued. I like that. Who had been rescued from evil spirits and healed of diseases. There was Mary, called Magdalene, who had been released from seven demons. There were others like Susanna and Joanna, who was married to Chuza, a steward of King Herod. And there were many others too. So this was a large company of people. It wasn't just the ladies there. It wasn't just the 12. It was a large company. And there were many others too. Now listen to this. These women played an important role in Jesus' ministry, using their wealth to provide for him and his other companions. Now, what I want you to see here, Jesus had a staff. And how many of y'all know it takes money to take care of a staff? But what I want you to see here, what motivated their giving and what motivated them to get behind Jesus was their love for him, number one. They loved him and his ministry. But also what they had received from him. That they received, some received a rescue, some received a deliverance, some received a healing. We don't know all the miracles that took place in these three scriptures. We know there were many. And what I want you to see is the motivation that was behind their giving. They were giving from a place of love, and they were giving from a place of gratitude. Amen. And so, you know, many of them were delivered, many of them were healed. By the word of God. And the reason why I'm bringing up this scripture is they were so excited. Now think about this. One of them had we know had devils that were delivered. Some were healed. Some were set free. All these different things were taking place. But notice this. Their motivation was to keep Jesus on the field and keep him going. Out of their appreciation for what happened to them, they knew other believers in other towns needed the same deliverance that they just received. And so it wasn't like, thank you, Jesus, appreciate you. It was, no, you know, we've received so much. And they're like, we received so much from Jesus. He changed our life. Some of us among us were healed. Some of us among us were delivered. Some of us among us, so many things took place. And it motivated them. Amen, because they knew other people, the other cities that he was going to. He went from town to town and city to city. And how many of y'all know it takes money to do that? But they were so excited about what happened to them that they wanted to sow into Jesus' ministry to keep him going. Now, I just think that's powerful because, you know, Pastor Nancy has a tremendous anointing on her life. As you know, and the places that she goes, people are ministered to, lives are changed, lives are touched. And the voice now is going to a broader audience. Many people around the world are getting delivered and set free. And when it comes to doing your part, that comes from a place of thank you. That comes from a place of, I appreciate you so much that I want to help keep you on the field to go to the next town. The next town on her itinerary is Florida. She's going there after here. So how many of y'all know, when we're excited, let me ask you a question. How many of y'all, with a show of hands, have received, or pastor, we say it this way, Pastor Nancy's ministry has impacted your life? I don't think there's a hand not raised. This is the way they felt. We have been so impacted. We have been so blessed. We want to minister to you out of our resources. We want to minister to you and we want to bless you so that you can keep going. How many of y'all know Jesus didn't say when they gave him this offering, Jesus didn't say, well, no, I'm the Son of God. I mean, I just call him, money just rains from heaven. He didn't say that. He received of their offerings because he was still a man in ministry on the planet that needed money to fulfill his ministry. And so he didn't rebuke him. He received from them. He received and I think the Amplified says out of their property, out of their personal resources they gave. Why did they give? Out of a place of appreciation. Out of a place that they've been rescued. Out of a place that you've impacted my life so much that I want to sow back into your ministry so that other people can experience what I've experienced. That's what these three verses are. There's a lot in there. But do you see that picture? Do you see Jesus showing up on the scene and you see people, a multitude of people, and they're all grateful and thankful, and you know they had to be talking amongst themselves what they received from Jesus and how the word was so rich and how their life was so blessed and all that he had done for them, and then the miracles. You know they were talking amongst each other. But it wasn't just that being appreciative. They did something to keep Jesus on the field. And that's what we want to do tonight. We want to sow towards Pastor Nancy because she's blessed our life. And how many of y'all know that same blessing that you've experienced where you've been delivered, where you've been helped? How many of y'all know there are people in the next place she goes to that needs that same thing that you've received here? And isn't it an awesome thing to think that you have a part to play in Pastor Nancy's ministry? Amen. Praise the Lord. And whether you stay with the stuff or you go with the person, just like David said, they part alike. Amen. You can't go to all the places that she's called to, but you can help send her. Amen. And she'll go and be well provided for. Isn't that wonderful? You think about Jesus' ministry. Jesus needed partners. And these were the partners that partnered with him. And they ministered to him. And I just think that's awesome. So we want to do the same thing tonight. We want to be a blessing to Pastor Nancy and her ministry, and we want to keep her on the field. Amen? So if you're giving by cash, lift your hand. The ushers are in the aisle, and they will serve you. Amen. And if you're giving by cash and you take one of those envelopes, please fill it out in its entirety so that we can properly receipt you. I love those scriptures. I love the fact that people partnered with Jesus. You know, we've been a partner with Pastor Nancy for many, many, many years. And it's just such a blessing to be partnered with this ministry. Amen. And we don't know the implications of all the times we've given. We don't see the reward yet, but you will. All the times that you said, you know, I want to be a blessing. I want to sow into this ministry to keep Pastor on the air. On the airways, maybe help her to go to the next place. And then the fruit that abounds towards that, you'll get rewarded too. And that's just awesome. Isn't that awesome? Praise the Lord. Well, hold your offering in your hand. We're going to pray over that. Father, we are we're just so thankful, Lord. We're so thankful for Pastor Nancy. We're so thankful for the ministry gift that you placed in her. And how we've all over the years have received a rescue and how we've received things in our life from this ministry. And it's an honor to be able to sow back into her life, to keep her on the field, to fulfill the plan of God, because this is what it's about, fulfilling the plan of God. And so we have a small part in a big plan. And Lord, we're grateful for that. And Lord, may this offering minister to her. May it help her to be able to provide the things that she needs to help her go to the next place. Well provided for. All her needs met. And we thank you, Lord, that Church on the Rock has a part to play in that. And so we honor you with our gifts tonight. And we sow them freely with all of our heart. And we thank you for receiving these gifts. And you said in your word, you'd multiply our seed sown. We put our faith in your word, and we thank you for it. And everybody said, amen. Please stand up with me if you would.
blessing and honor, glory and power, riches and wisdom and strength. Blessing and honor, glory and power, riches
sits at the right hand of
I came to worship you.
I came to seek your face.
Give glory and honor and power unto you, Jesus, the name above all names.
Jesus, the name.
unto you.
Be unto you.
Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. When we sing this, be unto you who sits at the right hand. He sits there because he raised us there. Amen.
Amen.
That's our place too. He doesn't sit there alone in the sense of he's authorized. The body sits in that place. Amen. Raised, seated with him. Amen. To become partakers of all that belongs to that throne. Amen. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. You are the worthy one who occupies that. And in your goodness to us, you raised us with you. And it was all the plan of the Father. And we thank you for the greatness of that plan. Hallelujah. We worship you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We'll turn around and give somebody around you a great big God bless you. Then you can be seated tonight. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Pastor, thank you so much for having us. We love being with y'all. Precious, precious people. And when he says that you have been partners with us for a long time, that's so, so true. And partners in more ways than one. So we appreciate this church family. And we're just grateful to be here with you. Amen. We have a few items back at the book table we invite you to get hold of. This one, the price of the double portion anointing, this is something that Jesus spoke to me in my hotel room when we were in St. Petersburg, Russia. And for about an hour, he talked to me about the price of the double portion anointing. And I know this, that not everyone will walk under a double portion anointing, but every one of us do have an anointing that abides within. And we need to know how to cooperate with that so that that anointing that abides within, we become skillful at drawing on it and allowing it to do what it came to do on the inside of us. Amen. And so that's out there. It'll be a blessing to you. Then we have this, a supernatural prayer life. Every time you begin to take time to speak in tongues, you just stepped into the supernatural. And We are so thankful that we have that infilling of the Holy Spirit that allows us to be to move accurately in prayer with God. That we're not just left to pray out of our minds or out of our emotions or based on circumstances, but we have the divine genius inside of us giving us divine utterance to speak out mysteries of God. So that's out there. And then we also have the Answer It book. This is such an important book. I guess we get more testimonies off of this book. This one and the Victory Over Grief and Sorrow are probably the two that people talk to us about the most about. Well, I'm going to have anything with the mind. A sound, disciplined mind and peace, living free from worry. Those things, because how many of you know everybody's got a mind and you better know how to deal with it. And part of dealing with our minds rightly, we have to learn to answer what ought not be in our minds. Amen. Amen. So those items are out there. We invite you to go back and get hold of those. Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you. We thank you. We glorify you. I wanted to quote something here, read to you a couple of verses, Acts chapter 20 and verse 22. Paul was making his way to Jerusalem, and Everywhere he would, as in his travels going back toward Jerusalem, every city he would go to, every congregation he would minister before, someone would minister to him about the difficulties he would face, the hardships that were awaiting him there. And so in those places, they would try to talk to him about, don't go. Because they thought that God telling him that there would be hardships was God telling him not to go. See, we assume. If we're not careful, we try to fill in the blanks ourselves. And we have to learn to just follow what God says. But God told him, Jesus appeared to him on one occasion, said, you have to stand before there in Jerusalem, stand before them and answer. And but all along the way, the people who would be ministering to him by the Spirit would pick up about the hardship, but then they would add their own onto it and say, don't go. And they would beg him not to go. And he wasn't confused by people's good intentions of trying to keep him safe. He just stayed on course with the plan of God. In Acts chapter 20, verse 22, he said, and now behold, I go bound in the Spirit. This isn't just something, this is something in my spirit. God has joined me to this. And whatever, this is a spirit thing. This isn't just something I've come up with. I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me, except this, save this, that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. So what's he saying? Every time he would go to a city, every time he's among the congregation, we know that Agabus stood up at one time and bound his own hands and feet and said, the man who owns this girdle, the same thing's going to happen to you. Yes. And they begged him not to go. But that wasn't God telling him not to go. That was God letting him know. Why? Because God makes us the head, not the tail. What's Amen. That mean? He keeps us in front of things, not behind That's things.
Good. Amen. Amen.
And to be forewarned is to be forearmed. God was not telling him that so that he would stay out of that place. He was telling him that so he would be prepared for what he would face. And he said, the Holy Ghost, he says, I go bound into the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. I like this next phrase, but none of these things move me. None of these things move me. What was he saying? Things have the ability to move you unless you decide they won't move you.
Amen.
And just know this, difficulties, opposition, circumstances come to move you to a different place than what God is taking you.
Right.
And you have to decide none of these things move me. Things that have ability to move us.
Amen.
Things that come into our minds, come against our lives, they have the ability to move us, but we decide if we're moved or not. Don't allow circumstances to write the story of your life. Because if you allow that, circumstances will push you into all kinds of places that God never led you to. Amen. So don't let circumstances do your thinking for you. Have you ever noticed the devil wants to do your thinking for you? That's why he tries to interject thoughts into your life. Because the enemy seeks to rewrite the story of our life through hardship. During times of hardship is when you have to guard your thinking more than any other time. Your thought life has to be guarded all the time, but when there's opposition and pressure, you better pay close attention to your thought life. Because those times of hardship are trying to insert something into your way of thinking. And if I could say this, it'll almost leach in the sense of seeping in little by little. The devil doesn't want a hard turn on your thought life. From right to wrong, because then it's recognized. He wants to seep in little by little, just leech into that thought life. And we have to decide that when we're faced with something, none of these things are moving me from right thinking. None of these things are moving me from what God planned for my life. None of these things, none of them, none of these things move me. So meaning this, no matter what comes against you, nothing can move you without your permission.
Yes. Yeah, that's right.
The opposition cannot move you from right thinking to wrong thinking without your permission.
That's right. Yes, ma'am.
Amen, because Paul said none of these things will move me. Dad Hagen makes this statement, and it's so well stated. He said the hair doesn't stay... The mind doesn't stay renewed any more than the hair stays combed.
Yeah. Right.
Meaning this, every day you have to get up and put your hair in place.
Yeah.
Please.
Amen.
And if we don't put our hair in place every day, others can tell.
Right.
If we don't keep our thoughts in place every day, before long, others will tell. They'll be able to recognize that. Financial hardship tries to move you. Marital hardship tries to move you. Business hardship tries to move you. The circumstances of life that just come from different arenas try to move you. And what are they trying to move you from? They're trying to move you from the wholesome definition of who God is.
Yes.
The accurate definition of truth of who God is. And you have to guard your thought life.
Amen.
You think about Joseph. And the life of faith is not a life of moments.
That's good. Yes.
It's a life of every day.
That's
right.
Amen.
That's so true.
You just get up every day.
Every day.
Yeah.
And live by faith.
Amen.
And too many times we can all point back to moments in our life where faith was evident and God met faith in a very pronounced way. And you're going to have moments, but your life of faith is not made up of moments. It's made up of every day doing the right thing, getting up and saying, today, my mind is kept by the power of God. Today, I hold right thinking in place. Get up and you say, today, I keep unforgiveness out. Today, I keep wrong thinking out. Today, I keep offense out. Today, Jesus is my healer today. He's my provider today. It's a daily flow to walk with God. You know, Joseph, of course, he was a shepherd boy for his dad. Until he started having some really interesting revealings of his future to him. And even once he didn't even understand.
Yeah.
He just saw parts of it. Why did God show him these dramatic things about his future? Seeing the sheaves of wheat bow down to him. What was this about? It was because the hardship ahead was going to be so severe that it gave him something to anchor to.
Amen. Amen.
So that he did not let these things move him off of God's course. God gives you his word to anchor yourself to.
Yes.
Haven't you ever seen, maybe they have an old pirates movie on TV, you know, the ships in the 1600s, 1700s and all that. And they'll be in a storm. And they will, sometimes they'll talk about, they would show in the midst of a tempest that men would wrap themselves to something. Why? So they wouldn't be washed overboard.
Right.
We don't just wrap ourselves to the word in the storm. We live wrapped.
We live wrapped. I like that. That's good.
So that none of these things move us. We're anchored. And when I've talked and referred to when my husband went home to be with the Lord, it was the greatest tragedy of my life, but it wasn't the hardest thing of my life. Why? Because I was already anchored to the Word.
That's right.
and that anchor, what I was anchored to, kept me from being moved into the wrong thing. Yes. So Joseph, when he sold by his brothers, what a special moment that was. Can you imagine how that could play on you? It's one thing for somebody who didn't even know you, didn't care about you, didn't like you, sold you. But when it's your own brothers, you know, that's a whole nother level of that's rude. That's just rude. Right? How that could play on the mind of a teenager. He was a teenager. But God showed him something before that happened so he could wrap himself to what God showed him and not be moved. Right? And he would be sold. I can't imagine what it's like that one day you're free. You're going where you want to go. You're walking where you want to go walk. And one day you're sold and nothing of you is free anymore. You don't know where you're going to end up. You don't know what kind of condition you're going to, circumstances you're going to be placed in. And he's bought by Potiphar. And there was something special about him that was so recognizable by a heathen. Yeah. Potiphar was a heathen.
Yeah.
He was not a man in covenant with God. And he wasn't a Jew. But he recognized there's something on this kid. Yeah. Yep. What was it? What he was anchored to.
Yes. Yes. Amen. Yeah. Amen.
It played out in the way Joseph conducted himself.
That's so good. Yeah. Amen.
And he didn't go in there and wreck shop. You know, Potiphar said, there's something about this one. Don't put him in the field. Put him in my house.
Yeah.
Right.
The favor of God upon him. Yes. Even in the hard place, he was elevated to the highest level of that hard place.
Yes.
What does that mean? No matter what hard place you face in life, there's a level to it. Yeah. Don't stay at the bottom level. Rise to the top, because that's how you get to the next level.
Yeah.
And he just kept rising to the top everywhere he went, even though he wasn't within his own charge. He wasn't in control of his own life. And he didn't go in there and try to ruin Potiphar. The Bible, in talking about him, says that everything of Potiphar's household was in his charge.
That's right.
Everything.
Yeah.
Everything. I have no doubt that it included the finances.
Yeah.
No doubt Potiphar taught him a little bit about something of finances.
Mm-hmm.
His daddy probably taught him a little bit. But Potiphar, he's working at a whole nother financially.
Right.
Here.
Right.
And he teaches him a little bit about how to run my business, how to run my household, how to keep things in check, how to keep things in place. He got a first-rate education by a military man who's at the head of this thing.
Yeah.
It looks like his life was getting worse, but he was getting an elevated education. But if he would have gone there thinking wrong about it, offended, mad at his brothers, steaming and stewing over them, how it would have affected what he would have taken in from Potiphar.
Yes.
You know, when you walk into a situation offended, nobody can get anything good into you.
That's true. Amen.
Because offense won't let good in. You hear everything twisted, and everything is taken in through your ear wrong. You read people wrong because you're reading everything through that flow of offense.
Yeah.
And so you don't hear conversations right. Everything is twisted in that. So we know that Joseph kept himself right because he became a student of Potiphar.
That's right. Yes.
And a pastor said to me one time, he said they were in the midst of a building program, and he said, I made one decision. And he said, it cost us $100,000. And he said, that was years ago. And he said, boy, I have felt so bad about that. I said, don't feel bad about that. You got $100,000 education off one decision, brother. Education costs you something.
Yeah.
It's not free. You learned it good. All these years, you can still tell what you learned.
Yeah.
There are people who sit in classrooms for years and can't tell you what they learned. Yeah. But I said, you had one good education, $100,000 education. Yeah. That's okay. Yeah. It put a lot of value on you, you know? Joseph was getting him a first-rate education. Yeah. Why? Because when God showed him his future, the devil was trying to rewrite his thought life. Yeah. He was trying to interject something in him that would take him off course so that what he saw, he would not arrive at.
Yeah. Wow. That's right.
Amen.
I don't know why I'm saying all this. It just kind of came into me as I'm sitting there. I was thinking I'm going to finish off talking about you about last night, about how expensive your daily blessing is. Because it is expensive. You're worth it. But God took this man, this young man, and he's got to get this young man from being petted by his father. His father was mishandling him. He was mishandling him. And I don't mean that in a mean, malicious way, but when you have multiple sons and you choose one to favor, you're in trouble. And you become the divider of your own home. And he was the father was the divider of that home by coddling this boy, giving him benefits, giving him treatment that would make him less than usable by God. And God knew I got to get him away from him, the father, to get him to where I'm taking him. Why? Because the father is going to make him look like, or the father was giving him a life of entitlement. I'm privileged. And he was displaying that even before the brothers. And it would twist Joseph to where God couldn't take him where he wanted to take him. And so We look at the brothers and say, boy, that was pretty rough treatment. But there again, the father put something in that family that caused that. You don't treat your children different. I'm going to tell you something. God doesn't treat his children different. One of us is not more important to him than the next. It's all the same price for all of us, the blood of Jesus. So if you start diminishing the value that he put in you, how we are not treating the price right. You were bought with a price. Don't cheapen it by thinking small. About him or about what's in you or about the plan of God for your life. Can I tell you something? One of the greatest enemies to your life is a poor self-image. People who have a poor self-image, you better put your foot to the neck of that thing because it will rob from you so desperately. And it's so difficult to bring someone with a poor self-image into fullness because they keep looking back at self. Know who you are in Christ and quit looking back at self. Who you are in Christ. Who you are in him. Not who you are in the family. I'm talking about your blood family. Or who you were in the school. How did you rate in the school system? Forget all of that. It's who you are in him that holds the greatness of his plan for your life.
Amen. Amen.
And here Joseph, God had a plan, not just for him, but it included him. And he had to take this young man and prepare him to sit on a throne. From being a shepherd in the field to a throne of ruling. Second in command in the greatest nation on earth. Yet as a teenager, he's coddled. As a teenager, he's treated with undue privilege. I like what, I'm not going political here, so don't think I am. I'm not going political. I just like certain statements that they were interviewing, I think, Ivanka Trump. Is that the daughter's name of President Trump? Yes. Ivanka? They were interviewing her and said, what do you think? You know, it's amazing, you know, you have, because he has like what, a Boeing 757 or something, which is a full commercial airline size for a private plane.
Yeah.
Like, we could all fit in there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And your luggage. And it would, yeah, and it wouldn't have a weight limit on your luggage. And so they asked her something about having a plane. She says, I don't have a plane. My daddy has a plane. I don't have one. They interviewed the mother years ago and talked about that when they would fly, before they had their own private jet, she said, I would fly first class, and then I bought them tickets in economy, and they sat in economy. And the kids would say to her, why do you sit up here and we sit back there? She said, because you didn't contribute. I'm wealthy. You're not. You're going to go back there. And it was so smart that they didn't treat them as though you don't have to pull your weight. But this is what Joseph was being deprived of. You know, it's important when you're around abundance how you think. It's very important how you think around abundance, because you can become very callous to people without abundance.
Yes.
And so Joseph was treated as one that would not, if he stayed in his father's household, he wouldn't arrive at God's plan. And so God allowed him. Did God do all this? No, God used all this.
Right.
And so he arrives, is sold into slavery, of course, serves under Potiphar, and he's getting a first-rate education. He's not going to the country school anymore out by the sheepfold.
Right.
He's now in a leading nation.
Yes.
And he's learning under a high-ranking officer.
Yes.
Who has great discipline, great structure, great order,
yeah,
great way of thinking. And now God has put him under this man, or allowed him to be put under this man.
Right.
Joseph could have blown it by how he thought. And not receive the things, sit there in bitterness and offense at what's happened to me, what I've gone through. But he sat there and took what that man offered him and put it on the inside of him, you see. And Potiphar had a lot of things going for him except one thing. He had a wife that needed a touch in her head. She was touched by something, you know. And accused Joseph falsely.
Yeah.
Ends up, they stage a mock trial. She's willing to let this be a mock trial.
Yeah.
She knows it's a mock trial.
Mm-hmm.
And he is accused, touching a high-ranking officer, and thrown into prison. And he's nothing but a kid, so who cares, mm-hmm, right?
Right?
No one cares. Mm-hmm. So he's down there in prison, and the whole time he's in prison, what is it? 12 years he's in prison. He's clocking his youth passing. He's spending his youth years in prison under a mock trial for something he didn't do. And it could have been a twisting moment. It could have been a great season in that season of hardship that could have twisted him up in so many different ways.
Yes.
And he just succeeded in prison by doing one thing, doing the right thing every day. Just doing the right thing every day. Keeping his heart right every day. Keeping his thinking right every day. Keeping his words right every day. He didn't accuse God. How many times people get mad at God when something happens in their life? That's wrong thinking. The devil loves for you to misapply blame. Why don't people say, I just, you know, in the world, they get so mad at God. No one ever says, I hate the devil.
Right.
No one ever unsaved says, I hate the devil.
No,
they're mad at God. And how many times people go through things and they blame God for what they're going through when it's really they let things move them. And he didn't let offense in. He didn't let unforgiveness in. He didn't let bitterness in. And even down in prison, you know what happened? He kept rising.
Yep.
Yes.
They put him in charge of everybody. You think Talk about HR department, human resources, having to deal with staff. He's getting a first-rate training. Why? Everyone down in that prison is in total rebellion. They're all mad. They're all twisted up. They're crazy down there. They're criminals. They're thieves. They're murderers. They're people that humanity could not handle. And so they're put in a place just to keep them restrained. And these are the men he's got to bring into leadership over them. What's he getting? Everybody's going to look easy after that group. And he goes, he's down there in the prison and learning how to work with the hardest personalities. People no doubt got devils. People no doubt, they're just mad, they're bitter, they're hard, they're harsh, they're mean, they're violent. And he's got to learn to lead them. Get them in compliance. It's amazing. What's he getting? A first-rate education. It looks like his life is falling apart to someone who doesn't know the plan. But when you know the plan, I'm getting a first-rate education. Because if I can lead these fellas, if I can make some kind of order out of this place and keep them from rioting and keep... One riots and we all die. You know, it's like they're mad, you know. He gets him a first-rate education of dealing with humanity. By the time he's down there 12 years doing this, keeping himself right, keeping himself clean, keeping his insides right. What is this? A walk with God is an everyday thing. It's not just moments. It's not moments. It's not crisis moments, then miracle moments. Then crisis moments and miracle moments that pull us out of crisis. The life with God is an everyday flow. That's when you're living the best. When every day, every situation, everything that comes, you bring it into the flow of what the Word says that you're anchored to. Amen. And so quit just putting great value on miracle moments. Amen. What about the moment you wanted to rip into that person? And on the inside you said, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. That's a miracle moment. It's the miracle of the love of God on the inside of you. Whether or not you fulfill the plan of God for your life goes back to your everyday life. It doesn't go back to your church life. It doesn't go back to how you served in church. It doesn't go back to how you read your Bible. It goes back to how you chose to live your everyday life. What's this mean? Value. Today, I'm going to walk with Him. Today, I'm going to obey Him. Today, I'm going to respond to Him. Today, I'm going to let what's in me dominate me. Every day is your proving day. Every day is to be your victory day. Not just tragedy days. Not just crisis days. Not just I'm behind in my bills days. Just every day walking with Him. That's what gives life its value. Is what how you live every day. So he, after 12 years, he wakes up one morning in that prison, just looks like every other day down in prison. His youth is spent. It's gone.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And the king had a problem. The Pharaoh had a problem. And he had men around him that they just weren't enough to answer his problem. And somebody remembered, there's a man down in prison that answered that, my problem. And he had no idea, I'm sure he had no idea that when he was ministering, what was it, to the baker and the wine taster, is that those the two that were thrown in prison? He probably had no idea that his release was connected with one of them. Not with the guy who died. No. So he wakes up one morning. It looks like, because he told him, remember me to the Remember me. Remember me. Why? Can you imagine? Out of sight, out of mind. And that was true.
Yeah,
he's unknown in that society. In Egypt, they know nothing of him. But the thing is, he was doing the right thing with the one who did know him. The one who knew where he was. He kept himself right in his sight. And so he wakes up one morning in the prison. It looks like it's going to be any other day until the Pharaoh says, somebody comes down, clean up. You're going to go before the Pharaoh. And he walks in there ready to be the vessel that can give a divine answer to the Pharaoh. Could he have done that if his insides weren't right? He'd have never received. He kept his insides right every day so that when divine answers were needed, he was the channel that was ready to be used for helping.
Amen.
You know, if you get into offense and this country that's been an enemy to you, you know, and the Pharaoh calls for you, it's like, who wants to help him? Let him have his own struggle. No. He didn't hate his captor. He didn't hate the government and the system and say, well, just let it all just fall apart. He didn't. And he gave a divine answer to the man. And the Pharaoh recognized there's something more in him than all these educated men around me. And that day, he woke up in the prison, but that night he went to bed second in command of the nation. Greatest in one day. One day. You don't ever know when that one day is, so you have to live ready. You have to live ready for places and times and days of promotion. Because God has days of promotion for all of us. So make sure you're ready for that day. Meaning, you can't just live any way you want, hang out with whoever you want to hang out with, go with anybody you want to go with, marry whoever you want to marry, you know, live wherever you want to live. No, you live every day ready for promotion day. I don't know that he thought much about promotion day. He's probably just thinking about getting through the day. But he did the right thing every day to keep himself right so that at a moment's notice when he's called, he's not trying to get himself right with God right before he goes up to Pharaoh. He was living right with God. He was ready with God's answer in his mouth. What was he on? The fast track of spiritual maturity. The fast track of... the fast track of growing up.
Yeah.
He starts out as about a 16, 17 year old on this really horrific course that no doubt pulled on him spirit, soul, and body from every direction. I love something that Buddy Harrison made this statement years ago. Buddy Harrison was Dad Hagen's son-in-law. And he said, God can pull you through anything if you can stay in the pool. I guarantee you God was pulling this young man. But there was pull on him in every way. You ever been through those seasons? Man, you feel the pull on every single thing. My husband used to preach this, if you just keep your heart right. If you just keep your heart right through that. He said you give God something that he can hook onto. He can hook onto a right heart. But if you let your heart go wrong, you get offended, then God's got no hook to pull you through with.
Amen. Amen.
And so at the end of that day, he goes to bed second in command of a nation. By 30, he's ready to run a nation. By 30 years old, you can look back at you at 30. Or we can look at those who haven't reached 30 and go, oh, no way. Seriously, but God called him ready.
Yes.
Not him saying he's ready. It was so cute. I have three grandbabies. And Bear, the middle one, his favorite thing is knives. Oh, that boy loves knives. He loved knives. I mean, you know, and he had the plastic swords when he was little. He had the Nerf swords and all the plastic. Anything with a sword, a knife, that boy just loved knives. And you'd go buy it, you'd say, come on, baby, we're going to go to the store and buy you something. He'd come out with the same knife he bought five times before. He just loved knives. Yeah. And then Bubby, he liked guns, you know. So they'd have all the Nerf guns, and they'd have the little stuff. And so one day, Bear came to Stephen and said, I'm ready for a real knife, a real sword. I'm ready. I'm ready for a real sword. He said, you're ready for a real sword? Yeah, I'm ready. You're six. You're not getting a real sword. And yeah, we laugh because we know. At six, you're not ready for what you're asking for. Can I say this? How many times have we asked for something we thought we were ready? We told God we were ready. Can I tell you what shows you whether you're ready? Opposition shows you whether you're ready. What does your mind do at a time of opposition? What do you let in at a time of opposition? It's not the good days that show you whether you're ready. It is the opposition that is the mirror to your life to show you whether you're ready for God's promotion in your life or not. What am I saying? Be ready inside all the time. Live ready. Live ready. Every day doing the right thing. Every day. Guarding your thought life. Every day feeding God's best into you. Every day yielding to your spirit. Every day responding to the Holy Ghost. Every day. Because one day you're going to need to know what He says. And if you haven't practiced responding, you're going to sit there confused. Because your spirit will speak to you and your mind will speak to you. And you'll have no idea which is which.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
And that I think it's one of the most interesting things about Joseph that when God brought him out of prison and when He put him in authority, it was in charge of the economy of a nation. The economy. It doesn't matter how great of a leader you have. If your economy collapses, the nation's done.
Yeah.
The economy, everything rests on that economy. When it comes to the greatness or the weakness of a nation, the success or the failure of a nation, it all points back to the economy. And God had a 30-year-old ready to run the economy of the greatest nation on earth. You talk about a divine education. The only thing is, he's never employed. He's never had his own bank account. Why? Because as a teenager, he's working for daddy. Yeah. You know why you have children? Free labor. I guarantee you, they all took their turns out in the field with those sheep.
Yeah.
Free labor. Get out there. Take your turn. He's not building a financial portfolio out there. He's not stacking up wealth. He works for daddy.
Yeah.
And then he's sold as a slave. How much you think they're paying slave rates?
Yeah.
There are no slave rates.
Yeah.
He's not getting paid. Then you go, can it get any worse? Just hang on, Joseph. You're going to prison. How much salary you think they're paying those prisons down there?
Uh-uh.
Nothing. Mm-hmm. He's paying no Social Security.
No.
He got no income. He's got no income. He's got no income. You understand this? He's got no income. Yet when he comes out, he's running the economy of a nation. How do you do that? Because evidently it's not money that trains you for money. Evidently. In God's plan, it's not money that trains you for money. It's your insides that train you for big stuff. No wonder people have a problem with the Father's care.
Because
their insides are off.
Uh-huh.
No wonder they're settling for less because their insides aren't enlightened. It's about an insides thing. I don't know of any 30-year-old I'd turn my finances over to, and it's not the economy of a nation I'd be handing them. But what was it that made him equipped? He knew how to hear from God. He knew how to hear from God. Why? His insides were right. If we decide to let the wrong thing in our thinking and in our insides, it will affect our ability to discern what God's saying to us.
Amen.
Worry doesn't hear God. Know that. You choose to step into the flow of worry, God's not in that flow. He can't be heard there.
Yeah, that's right.
If we let offense in, unforgiveness, about how somebody treated us, what they didn't do, they didn't give us our fair share, you don't hear God in that flow. Why? He's not there. Mm-hmm. He's not in that flow. To hear God, we have to stay in His flow.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
You understand that? Mm-hmm. When my husband went home to be with the Lord, the reason this ministry is here and thriving today, that's God's done it.
Yeah.
I tell you, God's done it.
Yes.
I'm not a legal person. I'm not a banking person. I'm not a city codes person. I don't know all, and yet I had to deal with all these things. I had to deal with them front, face to face. I had to go into meetings and confront things and deal with things. And that's not, I had never had that experience of having to do that. But I went in there, not with education, but I went in there with wisdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
God's wisdom.
Yeah.
God's wisdom.
I would hear from God.
Yeah.
Yes.
There was a 10-month situation that we had gone into with the city, with another person involving the city. And it had gone for 10 months, the city putting something in place with another party, but it affected us. And we needed the city to change. And for 10 months, they wouldn't change. So I got notified by the other party that they were going to go meet with the city the next day. And it was their project, not mine, but it affected us.
Mm-hmm.
And so I showed up because I knew that party was not going to be there fighting for us.
Yeah.
They were going to be fighting for them, and I was going to show up and protect us.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it was connected to our church property and all that. And I didn't know what my argument would be. I didn't know what to say other than this. I just got up and went on the back porch and started praying in the Holy Ghost. And then I got further into the spirit and started speaking out in psalms, hymns, singing, got into God's wisdom on the situation.
Yes.
And I kept hearing this word, victory. It's all I knew. I knew this before I went in, I win.
Yes.
Why? I took time to hear. I took time to hear.
Yes.
I made large decisions in the sense of dealing with millions of dollars based on, I had to hear.
Yeah.
I had to hear. There were big projects that my husband had left that needed to be completed. I didn't have the education or the experience, but I knew how to hear.
Right.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
What was this? It's about the insides. Yeah. And at every turn, I knew what answer to give. The staff will tell you, I've had different other ones tell me, one thing about Nancy, she's slow in making decisions. Why? Because I don't like to decide it twice.
Amen.
I want to know it once.
Yeah.
I have to do it twice. I got to undo some stuff.
Yeah. True.
It's faster to go slower.
Yeah. 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 Yes.
Yes. Said it's faster to go slower. To hear. I take time to hear. Because there are, when I make a decision in my life, I make a decision for the ministry, I'm not the only one in the vehicle of this.
True.
of this decision.
That's right.
My family's in it.
Yeah.
The staff is in it.
Yes.
The congregation is in it.
True.
And on your inside, you have to realize it's not just about me and what I want.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right.
That's a thing that'll keep you in a place of not being able to be promoted when it's just about me and what I want.
Yeah.
Right. What suits me.
Yeah.
It's about the whole.
Yes.
Can I tell you something about, you look at back at creation.
Yeah.
Day one, and it says, and after day one, it says, and it was good. After day two, creation, and then it says, and it was good.
Mm-hmm.
Day three, creation, and it was good. At the end of day five, creation, it said, and it was very good. What was it? God stood back and just didn't look at how day one looked. Didn't just look at how day two looked,
yes,
what was created on those days, but how does it all work together? God stood back and looked at the whole thing, and it was all good. It's small that just looks at how it affects us. It's how does it affect my local church? How does it affect my family? How does it affect the body of Christ, what I'm doing and how I'm living? This is all about the insides of a man. Joseph came out at the age of 30 and was ready to run a nation because he cared about the nation more than him. God saw he cares more about something other than him. I can trust him with more than something other than his life. This is what I'm talking about. This life in God, it's an everyday thing, people.
Yes.
It's an everyday walk.
Yes. Amen.
God sees how we treat people every day.
Yes.
True.
And that's either our approval or our failing grade for what happens the next day.
Yes.
You know, you just think, well, I'm just going to give them a piece of my mind there at the place. You know, they did me wrong. Well, you know, you also gave them a piece of your promotion.
There you go. Yes, yes, yes.
Can I tell you what God said to me years ago?
Yes.
I'm talking one particular time. I'm not saying God just talked to me years ago and that was it. Oh, my goodness. Maybe 25, 30 years ago. I won't tell you all the components. I'll just tell you. So there's more components I'm not telling you, okay? I don't have to tell everything. Now, Ed did, but I don't have to. I do the edited version. But somebody said something. We were sitting at a table, and somebody said something, and it was negative. It showed me in a negative light, and I'm going, I'm not even in the conversation, and I'm going, what? Did I just hear? I nodded. What? Everybody likes me. What's your thing? You know?
Yeah.
And so I thought, because this is a person I was close to. And I thought, I'm going to talk to them because I'm not a confrontational person. I'm not. You know, some people, they thrive on confrontation. It's like fuel to their tank.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not a confrontational person, but I will confront because I've had 25 years of pastoring. To keep the congregation safe, I've confronted, believe me. But I don't pastor based on my personality. I pastor based on the word.
Amen.
You pastor based on your personality, the devil will send all kinds of problems your way. But you have to pastor based on the word. You have to live your life based on the word, not just on your personality.
Amen.
And so I had to step over my own temperament, my own makeup to obey God. In case you didn't know it, every time you obey God, you have to step over something of your flesh to do it. And so this person had said something, I thought, you know, because of the relationship we had, I thought, we're not going to let this go.
Yeah.
We're going to have a talk. And so I had on the inside of me, if I could say this, a constraint toward that. And I go, oh, no. No. Because I got scripture.
Yeah.
And my scripture is this: if someone offends you, you go to them privately. I'm not going to go public. I could, because I could have right there in the in that setting you did something in, I could have taken that to a whole nother level right there. Right there. And we could have just had a show. But I didn't. I kept my mouth shut. And I took the hit publicly. But I'm gonna talk to you privately. Because the word says, if someone offends you, go private. Go to them privately, right? So I'm going to talk with them. And the whole time I kept having that constraint on the inside of me. And I said, No, I got scripture. No, I'm stepping all over this. No. Anybody ever been there? Is it just me?
No.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes. So they came in. It was on the road. It wasn't at home. And so they had come in and we were in the hotel room. And, we travel with different people and there's always people around and, you know, so I was having private time with them. And I said, you made a statement at the table. And I said, wow. I said, it was a little bit noticeable. And I said, if you have an issue, talk to me. Hello. Don't talk to the table.
Yeah. Right.
Talk to me.
Because
what was said was inappropriate. I said, talk to me. And I thought they would say, I didn't even think. Yeah, you're right. You think that they're going to acknowledge something. Well, they didn't. It was like, I don't give a rip what you think. I go, okay, all right, we're going to play. We're going to play that. All right. So they walked out. They just shirked it off and walked out. And I go, okay, all right. And God said, I want to talk to you. And I said, all right. I'm in that mood right now, I'm in that flow. And he said, not every scripture is for you. I go, no. He said, not every scripture is for you. I go, I don't know if I buy that. Well, you look at it, and there are some scriptures written to husbands. They're not written for the wife. They're written to the husband. And you'll have husbands, wives submit. You know what that verse says, that first word is wives. It's talking to the wives. So husbands, stay out of that verse.
Right.
I'm not going to stand in front. But seriously, it says wives. If you're not a wife, he's not talking to you. And it doesn't work for the husband to take what he said to the wife and try to jam it down the throat of the wife.
Yeah. Right.
Because if God can't get it down, or you can't.
Yeah, that's good. That's right.
And it will bite you.
Yeah.
If you try to put down somebody,
yes,
what only God can put into somebody.
Yes.
Yeah? Then he said, some scripture are written to the Jews. You're not Jew. I'm talking about blood Jews. Some are written to others. Some are written to, woe to the rich man who is withholding, And then the harvesters are crying out because the rich man, woe unto you. So see, there are verses that are written to certain ones. Yet we can learn something from all of them, but we're not necessarily personally being addressed in that. Do you understand?
Yes.
So God said, not every verse, not every scripture is for you. And I said, the scripture I picked is. It says if someone offends you, go to them privately. He said, yes, that was written for someone who took offense. I was telling them how to get free from the offense they took. I don't permit you to take offense. I expect you to walk in love. Shoot, I lost that one. That's what he said. He said that verse is for the person who took offense. You're not allowed to take offense. I go, no, I'm not. I don't allow offense for my own standard. My own standard of where I've grown to in the Word. I don't take offense. I don't. I'm not an offended person. I don't take it. Why? Because the love in me is greater than the offense offered me. What was he doing all those years ago? He's dealing with inside things. Why? Because he knew that one day I'd be running a ministry. He knew that one day we're in 500 million homes with the broadcast. We just got contacted by the first, and I don't know, maybe you know, David, the first and only Christian broadcasting network in Russia. I don't know, are they the only one? I know they were the first. I don't know that
they're the only one.
And they just contacted us, putting us on for free.
Wow. That's awesome.
In their online, just in their online church, in their online church, they have 250,000 members in their online church. And they have me to film teachings for their conferences online. And but what if I hadn't gotten years ago when God said that verse isn't for you? But what if I said, no, that verse is for me? I want, see, where God can take us is determined by what we'll choose every day. What we choose every day. What we choose every day. It's an everyday walk. God is watching. He knows your home. He knows how you talk to each other in the home, because he's looking for the opportunity to bring you into more. And he's looking into our home to see if we're ready or not. The way we are in church is not the real us. It's the way we are when nobody knows what we're thinking. Nobody sees where we're at. Nobody knows what we're doing. But how we're keeping our insides.
Amen.
How we're keeping our insides.
That's right.
Now, we are in Christ. We are in him. We should be living that.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. And too many times people are saying, God, take me further. And he's trying, but he does it from within.
From within.
He does it from within. Brother Copeland makes this statement. He said, God works on us from the inside out. The world works on themselves from the outside. And they don't even arrive at the end half the time. It's all on the outside. It's all on the outside. But God's not building a man from the outside. He's building a man from the inside. So it does matter when he tells you to do something, how you treat that. It does matter when you have sensed something in your spirit, how you respond to that. Because all of these everyday things are what he's going to use to prepare us for what we're born for. He prepared Joseph to run the economy of a nation without any money, but with totally his insides, working his insides. Why? Because if you can get someone to follow their insides, God can direct them in their finances, in their marriage, in their business, in their church, in their serving in the body of Christ, in their call, he can just get them to listen. Can I tell you one of the most valuable things that you can develop in you is the desire to be teachable. Because someone who's teachable will listen. When you're hard-headed, when you're bullheaded, going to demand your own way and not sensitive to be taught, sensitive to what you hear, you'll be on the slow track of promotion. Be teachable. Can't be a know-it-all. Can't be overly opinionated. You know, when we got redeemed, we got redeemed from having to have an opinion. Opinions can disqualify us from what God has for us. Well, I don't think that, Pastor. I wouldn't have a person around me like that. They're not safe. Well, I have a right to my opinion. Don't bring your Americanism into the Bible.
There you go.
That's American stuff. Thank God for our freedom, but we have a higher law we live by, and it's the law of love.
Yes.
And can I tell you this? when someone just says, you want to know my opinion about it, or this is my thought on it, they're saying, I have no authority.
Yeah.
And if we have no authority, we should learn to practice no opinion.
That's right.
If I don't have authority, none of my business. None of my business. None of my business. None of my business. None of my business.
Amen.
You know, I've had precious talks with very precious people that mean a lot in my life. And God's brought some precious, precious, wonderful people in my life. And they have, if I could say, told some very intimate secrets, family things of their own heart. And I say to them, when I walk out of this room, it's forgotten. Mm-hmm. It doesn't go anywhere. Mm-hmm. I want you to know what you said is safe.
Yes, yes.
You won't hear it. Mm-hmm. You won't hear it from the back door through me.
Right.
I want you to know, I won't be thinking about it. Mm-hmm. I won't be meditating on it and think, I can't believe they're struggling with that. I won't even touch it in my thought life.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because what you've told me is safe from my thought life.
Yeah.
Because, see, you carry things in your thought life, you start developing opinions about people.
Yeah.
And how what you think they ought to do, and I can't believe, you better stop. Another man's business is not your own, no matter how much they've told you of it. God needs to know that people are safe with you.
There you go.
God needs to know that. Those are the people that God can promote. So Joseph is here. He's promoted. He's sitting second in command of a nation. Brother, this is the time to level out the record now. But he didn't.
Nope.
This is the time to show it out how far beneath you are to me, to his brothers. And he didn't. When they came, he wept. What was that? His time with God made him tender, not hard-hearted.
Yes, yes.
You see. Why did God put him on the throne? For one reason, to rescue the nation.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Not the nation of Egypt, the nation of his own people.
Yes, yes.
And in that, Egypt was rescued. He wasn't there because God was impressed with him. He was there because God empowered him.
Amen.
So we can't get real proud of ourselves for being used, because the only reason we get anywhere that God uses us is because God on the inside empowers us. We're sober about there's nothing in us except Him.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
So his brothers came and he showed how large he was inside. They lived tormented. Mm-hmm. You can't tell me they didn't live tormented.
Mm-hmm.
Of what they had done.
Yeah.
And but God was giving him a first-rate education, getting him prepared for where he had for him to go. Don't kick against the things in your life that put something in you, that put a demand on you.
Yeah.
Right.
And if you handle opposition right, it becomes your promotion place. If you get offended and get upset when something comes against you and people talk against you, any opposition, God intends for it to become a promotion platform.
Amen.
Because how you handle it, God will say they're ready for the next level. If you handle it with offense, you stay where you're at, and you could lose where you're at. But if you say, I keep myself clean, I keep myself right, I'm going to pray for them, God says, they're ready for the next thing I have for them.
Amen.
How you handle everyday opposition is a picture of your walk with God.
Wow. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
That's so good.
And God invites us to hardly even notice when we're done wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We have to notice it enough to employ love. But not notice it enough to get tripped up by it.
Yeah. Wow. Amen.
Well, it's different tonight. I was just gonna have a talk about how expensive, how lavish God is toward us. But it's from the inside out. Because see, we all want the highest place God has for us. Because listen, it's a process. We all want it. But we have to handle the process right. God said to me something. The pastors are so generous. They have always been so. This congregation has always been so generous to us. And pastor's talking about the offering going to me. Last year and this year, God said to me last year, because I haven't, when Ed died, I did not raise my salary, and I hadn't had a salary raised several years before he died. So that's not changed in the last, he's been gone over 10 years now, yeah. And I haven't changed my salary. Why? Because it was just in my heart that God said, I will prove to you my care.
Yes.
And he just keeps, it just comes in through other avenues, because I'm not limited to think that my only, my only avenue of provision is my salary. That's the least avenue I have.
Yes.
That's the most limited avenue.
Yeah.
And so all these years I've never taken any more, you know. But God just makes it up other ways. And so when God gave me Sister Amy's castle, you've heard me talk about a little bit of that testimony. And when I bought that castle, I bought a renovation. And I mean, the renovation is looking to be like three times more than the cost of the castle. It'd be cheaper to, I know if Ed were alive, you know what he'd done? He'd have bulldozed that place. Because the spot is fabulous so far as the view. It's just, but to rescue what's there is expensive, but that's okay. Because what do we know about God's care? It's expensive. And so I was saying last night, across the lake, there's that property that God is going to bring into our hands for the ministry as well. And I've said to my kids and I've said to the staff, because I've involved them in this reconstruction process, because I said, none of us have experience of building. Ed had it. But I said, none of y'all have it. And so I said, I'm using this to train the staff on dealing with, you know, contractors and all the processes of this. And so I said, so I'd said to my kids, I said, two, God is training us, because I'm paying cash for it as I go, you know. And I said, God's training us to believe for the money. We start with a very little amount, just a fraction of what's needed, but at least it's enough to start with. And you just keep going, just like y'all have done. You're sitting and you started. If you hadn't have ever started, you wouldn't even be sitting here. You started with what you had. You got to start. And so that's what I've done. And I said to God, I said to the kids, and I've said to God, and thank you for giving me this project to train my faith in believing for buildings. Thank you for that. I appreciate that. That you're not giving me where we're headed to train me on. You're giving me something that's so doable for me to train me on. And then recently God said to me, he said, it's true. He said, you're training for the financial arena, but he said, bigger than that and more than that. What I'm using this house renovation on is to train you most in is how to be untroubled by the process. Untroubled by the process. It's not just about getting the money. It's about being untroubled even when it looks like there's not the money. Even when it looks like things are going the wrong direction. He said, that's what I'm trying to train you in, how to be untroubled in the face of the process. Why? Because the next levels are millions and millions and millions of dollars. And I know how the devil has tried to sit on my head about even something that's a fraction of what the future is going to call for. And I've learned how to be untroubled at that. Can I tell you what? If God puts you where you were born for without being properly prepared, you would be so troubled you'd tear that place up. And the devil would take you out of that place you were born for. He prepares you by learning how to be untroubled every single day, because you have anchored yourself to the word to be a doer of the word every day, every day, every day, every, not just church day, not just when people are around, not just when the pastor hears you. I know people put on their best behavior around pastor. I mean, I can sit on an airplane and they find out you're a pastor and all of a sudden they sit different. Everything is different. when they find out you're in ministry because they're performing. Yeah. Whether it's purposeful or not, they kind of sit up a little straighter. Right. They monitor themselves, you know. But if we live, we live under strict watchfulness. Amen.
Yeah.
Well, praise the Lord. Why? God's telling us how to arrive at what we're born for.
Yes.
You're born for something more than the place you're at today.
Amen.
There's always more. I don't care there's how old you
more.
Are. There's always
yes.
more.
Yes.
Always, always, always. There is no finish line to God's plan.
Amen.
There's no finish line.
There's no finish line.
As far as you'll go, He'll keep taking you further.
Yeah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Don't stop short. Don't stop short of the finish line. Amen. Praise
Amen.
The Lord. Stand with me to your feet tonight. Father, we thank you so much. Thank you for the greatness of your plan for each and every one.
Yes.
Each and every one of us. The greatness of your plan. We're grateful, Father, that you're working in us.
Yes.
It is you. You're working in us both to will and to do. Of your good pleasure. Father, you don't even leave it up to us to work at all. But you empower us to walk it out. And we thank you, Father, it's all within the greatness of your plan. We worship you tonight. Just lift up your hands and let's worship him. Lift up your voice and worship him tonight. We worship you, Father. We glorify you. We thank you, Father. You got something you want to say?
Glorify your name. We glorify your name. Glorify your name in all the earth. We glorify your name, glorify your name, glorify your name in all the earth.
Everybody just lift that up.
Appreciate that God's had us to go this direction tonight, because you know what that does? That places great value on every day.
True. Yes.
It places great importance
yes.
on every day, that we don't just live it mindless, and that we treat one day as not every day's a walk with Him.
Yes.
Every day's a walk. And somebody asked Smith Wigglesworth during the course of his ministry. He was in a Bible school. And a student asked him, said, how did you arrive at the place, number one, where you are so keen in following the Holy Ghost, and number two, so strong in faith? He said, first the blade, then the ear, then the full corn in the ear. What is it? It's a process. Value the process, not just the corn. Don't just value the end result. Value the process. I've seen so many people who calls a God on their life, but all they focused on was the call and not the process that would enable them to fulfill the call. And they aborted their process. Seen it time and time again. Many are called, few chosen. Why? Because few will go through the process to fulfill the call. Few will consecrate themselves. Few will be watchful in their everyday life. You know, my dad being a cotton and wheat farmer, every day he went out and checked the crops. Every day. Why? Because there was something happening every day in that field. Every day something was happening in that field. Sometimes he could start seeing, you know, certain levels of growth. Sometimes he was going to see if weeds had started growing. Others he was going to see if any kind of rodents were in there or some kind of insect had gotten there. Sometimes he's just checking to see what the wind conditions were. Sometimes he's seeing what the moisture level is. Every day he was checking his crops because something was going on every day with the ground. Every day. And he would get up in the middle of the night so many times. Now I remember times I felt so sorry for him because, I mean, bitter cold, you know, and we live in the plains area to where lots of wind. And it would be, you know, down around zero and the wind blowing 30 miles an hour. And he'd have to go out in the middle of the night and go do something to, you know, protect the crop, whether keeping the topsoil from blowing off or whatever. And because the ground every day determined the harvest that he got. Don't treat your life as just moments. It's every day. It's every day. Your spiritual life is not just about church time. It's not just about services. I came to church. It's every moment of the day that God's work in our garden.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Every day. Value every day. Walk with God that day. Turn toward Him that day. Move with Him that day. Respond to Him that day. Feed your faith that day. Guard your thinking that day. Answer the enemy every day. Amen? And when you do that, it makes you so God inside minded that you live completely different. Amen? Well, praise the Lord. We worship you, Father. We worship you. We thank you. We thank you, Father. The Father's care is for every single moment of our life. You know, our boss, men we work for, the company we work for, they're interested in one thing, what you're doing during those work hours.
Yeah.
But God's interested in every hour. Every hour of your life. No one is interested in every hour like God is interested in every hour of your life. Amen. That He offers Himself. You can come and abide with me. Every single day, you can live your life from that place. So learn. Learn to do that. Amen. Father, we thank you. We're so honored. We're so honored that we are in Christ. Thank you for that. How that elevates everything of our existence to know that we are in Him. And in Him is everything He is. In Him is everything that belongs to us in Christ. That you offer us the best and the highest flow every single day of our life. So we honor you. We turn toward you. We turn our attention toward you. We acknowledge you every day throughout every moment of the day, we acknowledge you. We acknowledge you. And as we acknowledge you, we step into a place of your presence that elevates every single aspect of our life. And we thank you for it. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Father. Well, are you helped tonight? Wasn't that wonderful? We decide the outcome of our day, not the pressure. We decide how we walk. You know, the scripture I want to leave you with tonight, the pastor was ministering. The scripture came to me. It says in Romans chapter 14, verse 5, it says, one man esteemeth one day above another. Another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. Which simply means you decide what kind of day you're going to have. The pressure doesn't dictate your day. Your faith does. And if you wake up every morning, like Pastor taught us, and you keep your heart toward heaven, and you walk by faith, greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. There's nothing you'll face in this life that the greater one can't, through you, defeat. Faith is the victory. It's not a victory. It is the victory that overcomes. Everything you face in life can be overcome by your faith. But it's making that decision every day, today, regardless of what comes, like Pastor taught us. I'm not going to teach another message. But every day, you have to determine. It says right here, every person can esteem one day above another, or you can esteem every day alike. That regardless of what comes today, I walk by faith and not by sight. See, I am determining my day. I'm not letting the situations determine my day. And that's a scripture you can use. It says one man esteems one day above another. You don't have to. You can esteem every day alike. That I walk by faith and not by sight. Amen. And I'll tell you, when you walk by faith, it's the most exciting life you could ever live. And you walk in victory knowing that no matter what comes your way, I win. I will win because of my faith in God. Amen. Thank you, Pastor. So wonderful. So helpful. So needed. Amen. So needed. And we're grateful. Father, we honor you. Tonight, we honor the word. We're so helped tonight, so grateful. Thank you for speaking the words to us tonight that helped encourage, inspire us, correct us, help us. We honor you in this place. We thank you, Lord, that you put on the inside of us the greatest thing you could ever put on the inside of us, and that's faith. Your love and your faith, the love of God's been shed abroad in our heart. We have the faith of God on the inside of us. We're greater. What's in us is greater than the storms. What's in us is greater than the trials and all the things that we face. If we learn every day, like Pastor said, every day, walking by faith, not just moments, but purposefully every day, determined to contend for the faith, to walk by faith every day. And we so grateful tonight. Amen. Aren't you grateful tonight? Praise the Lord. Well, let me dismiss pastors and go ahead and dismiss you. You don't want to miss tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. We'll be back. And I don't know about you, but I'm coming expecting. You coming expecting tomorrow? Praise God. God is so good. Say, God is so good. Father, we're grateful tonight. I call your people blessed. The angels of God go with us as we leave this place. And we thank you, Lord, that we determine every day to walk by faith. And we honor you in this place. And I call your people blessed. And everybody said, amen. Please visit the book table and buy all those books up in Jesus' name. God bless you. We love you. You're dismissed.